Good day. I'm Norman Warburger. In this video, let's talk a little bit about definitions, specifications, and interpretation of definitions. To illustrate the ideas, let's go back to our basic concepts of geometry. So recall that we defined a point, A, to be a pair of numbers, actually rational numbers. We defined a line L to be a proportion, A to B to C, of rational numbers, with a certain condition on A and B, not being both zero. We defined a triangle, A1, A2, A3, with a bar over it, to be a set of three points, not collinear. We defined a circle in terms of this proportion involving six numbers, the proportion 1 to 0 to 1 to minus 2a to minus 2b to c. So these are also part of the definitions. We say that the point A lies on the line L, this point lies on the line L, precisely when ax plus by plus c equals 0. And the point A lies on the circle C, precisely when x squared plus y squared minus 2ax minus 2by plus c equals 0. So we made these definitions, and they're quite different from the usual definitions that one finds in geometry texts. So we did not define a line as an infinite set of points. We did not define a circle as an infinite set of points. So a useful guiding idea is that mathematical definitions should be concise, clear, and close to specifications. I mean the information required to determine a particular mathematical object. To illustrate that, let's look at a triangle. All right, so here's a triangle, and let's think about the question of how to define what a triangle is. This is a question that's finessed in almost all geometry books, rather amazingly. Even though a triangle is absolutely fundamental mathematical object, somehow people think it's not necessary to define what it is exactly. Well, I think it is very important to define exactly what it is. And for me, a triangle is a set of three points which are not collinear. But there are also other possibilities. You could also define a triangle as a set of three line segments. Well, line segments have the property that they're meeting at the corners. Or you could define a triangle in terms of three lines. Line L1, L2, L3. Or you could define a triangle in terms of the area or the region bounded by it. So you could think of this actual region as being the triangle. Now, I'm not saying that these are wrong. These are all legitimate variants or possibilities. But there's something a little bit more efficient about this one than these three. Suppose, for example, that we have a particular triangle in mind, and we want to send the information to specify that particular triangle to our friend on the internet. So we can't draw a picture, we just want to send some amount of data. With this description, we need to send the coordinates of this point, and this point. So 2, 2, 2, 6 pieces of data will specify this triangle. With this approach, we need to specify the three line segments. To specify a line segment requires two endpoints. So we have 2, 2, 2, but each one of these endpoints is itself a point. So we have 6 times 2, 12 pieces of information to specify the triangle via line segments. Via lines, well, if we think of a line as being a triple, A, B, C, then we have 3 plus 3 plus 3, 9 pieces of information required there. And there's also a little bit of ambiguity because lines are only defined up to scalars. And then if we want to define this, well, it's not so clear how you can define that as a region or how you're going to express that region except by doing one of these three things and talking about the region inside given a situation like this. So my point here is that if you have to define a new mathematical object, let's say you've just discovered a squiggle, and this is a new idea that you want to introduce to mathematics, and you have an intuitive idea of what a squiggle is, but you would like to make a clear mathematical definition, then my suggestion to you is to ask yourself the following question. Suppose I have a particular squiggle, whatever it is, and I want to convey that information to somebody else via the internet. What is the minimal amount of information that I have to compose to be able to completely specify the squiggle? You have to think about the most efficient way of encoding that information and then try to make your definition as close to that specification as possible. So when specifications and definitions are close together, then you have a pleasant theory. Now let's talk a little bit about the interpretation of mathematical definitions. So mathematical definitions can be visualized or interpreted or modeled in different ways. This is an interesting idea with a lot of ramifications. So let me try to explain it through a very simple example. When we defined a point originally, we were thinking, and I drew a picture of a plane and a dot, and I said that's the point, and we're going to describe or define what that point is. And we decided on an ordered pair to denote the x and the y coordinates used to specify that point. So that was our definition of a point, and that was our visualization. It represents a dot in this two-dimensional plane. But some people might object to this definition. The definition of an ordered pair without a diagram seems to be completely divorced from the geometry. You can't necessarily tell what the geometry is. That's actually a good thing. And it's because it gives us a flexibility in interpreting what our mathematics is really about. It turns out that there's more than one way, often, of modeling or interpreting a given mathematical expression or formula or result. So to give you an example of some alternatives, here's a different picture that also models the idea of a point. So now I've taken this XY plane and I've slanted it so that it's in this horizontal plane, which you should think of as being essentially horizontal here. And we now have a third dimension or third axis, the Z-axis, running perpendicular from the page. Our original point, that red one, is now lying in this horizontal plane. And now I want to imagine a vertical line that goes through this point, which is parallel to the Z-axis. So it's actually coming out of the plane. And now we say, well, we can interpret the point A, 3, 2, as not representing that point, but actually representing that line. So imagine a three-dimensional creature that had no two-dimensional visual ability, and that could only feel things. Okay, they could feel things. So a creature like this might have trouble feeling a dot on a plane, but would be very comfortable feeling a line in three-dimensional space. There's an obvious correspondence between points in the plane and lines in three-dimensional space, which are all vertical. Here's a third example for the same thing. We still have the plane now lying horizontally. There's our original point. But now what I'm doing is I'm fixing a point on the Z-axis, so some fixed black dot. And what I'm doing is I'm connecting points on the plane with this fixed black dot to make lines which are all going through that point. And now I can interpret this point, 3, 2, as not representing this dot, not representing the vertical line through it, but rather representing this slanted line through the point and our fixed dot. In this picture, theorems of geometry become theorems about these lines through this fixed point. Any theorem in Euclidean geometry that you can frame, you can reformulate in terms of a picture about lines that have this particular property. And it might be that on some other planet, this is a preferred way of thinking about things. So we're not going to say that one of these is better than the other. We can use whichever one is convenient to us. The definition rides above all interpretations of it and gives us a flexibility that can be very useful. Next time, we are going to talk about some other aspects of elementary geometry. We're going to look at definitions of quadrilaterals and polygons. I hope you'll join me for that. I'm Norman Walberger. Thanks for listening.